will now commence. This meeting is necessary for the council to continue operations of the city and to discharge its duties, lawful purposes, and responsibilities, and is being held pursuant to and in compliance with the City of Norfolk Ordinance 48161 as authorized by Virginia Code Section 15.2-1413 and will be conducted telephonically and electronically. Notice of this meeting was given to the public on November 27, 2020 in the Virginia Pilot. An electronic copy of the agenda was posted on the city's website on November 27, 2020. No public comment will be taking place during this work session. Dr. Filer, before you take the floor, I want to make sure that Mr. Bull, we have a quorum.
Yes, sir, we do have a quorum.
Okay. Dr. Filer.
All right. Thank you, sir. Mayor, Vice Mayor, members of council, good to see you all this afternoon. Have a pretty full agenda for today, plus we have council interests, so I'm going to get right to it. We've got, to start with this evening, Aaliyah Slappy-Wilson with Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion, our Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Officer, Marsha McGill with the St. Paul's Transformation, and Mike Beavis, our Chief Procurement Officer. They're going to join us this evening to talk about a policy the council has been asking us to think about and work on for some time. In fact, pretty much, I think, since I came in last year. And it's the development of a economic inclusion plan and procurement policy plan for the city. And this would include not only city operations, but also any of these development agreements that we do in which the city would be involved. The next week on your agenda will be a resolution establishing goals for small women and minority-owned business participation. And so what we wanted to do this evening was give you an opportunity to see where we are in the possible language of that resolution, so that if we need to make any changes between now and next week, we can do that before we bring that to you all for a vote. After that, we're going to have Doug Beaver with our Chief Resilience Officer provide an update on our Ohio Creek Watershed Project, which is making really good progress. After that, with the start of the colder temperatures, I thought it would be helpful to have Deputy City Manager James Rogers, along with Sarah Fuller, to talk about our Nest for this winter. Obviously, Nest is going to look and feel very different than what it's felt like in the past because of the COVID restrictions, but we believe we have a great path forward, and thanks to some just really wonderful partners in the city, we're going to be able to make this happen to keep all of our homeless folks safe throughout the colder temperatures. And then we're going to end with Pete Burek, our Director of Civic Lab, and Fraser Picard, our Chief Information Officer. They're back to present data on internet access, which I believe Councilwoman McClellan had asked us to sort of take a look at, not just simply where we had hotspots, but could we get some actual data on access points across the city, and are we putting our hotspots and our internet accessibility in the areas of the city where we see a large demand for access. At that point, we'll take a look at the clock and see how long it's taken to get through those presentations. We may take a bit of a five-minute break or so to let everybody stretch their legs before we get into council interests. Then we'll close with council interests, and then we'll go into closed session for a personnel matter.
Okay. All right.
All right. With that, let me turn to Aaliyah, Marsha, and Mike, and I believe they are all making their way online. And I think Aaliyah Ken also has a presentation. As I mentioned, this is a preview of the policy that will come before you all next Tuesday. I think the team has worked extremely hard over the last several months to put together a policy that I believe is fair, a massive improvement over where we are currently, and also provides attainable goals based on some of the numbers we've seen for the various industries in the region. Aaliyah, are you, I think, yep, okay, I see you, Aaliyah. Yep, welcome, Aaliyah, and take it away whenever you're ready.
Good afternoon, Mayor, members of council, and Dr. Filer. We're excited to be with you today to discuss our economic inclusion plan and procurement policy. One of the first things back in March of 2018, when I stepped into this role as Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Officer, One of the first steps that we took was outlining what the priorities would be as related to this role. And if we could go to the next slide to see those priorities. It was four key focus areas: outreach and neighborhood engagement, inclusive economic growth, planning and infrastructure, and human resources and workforce development. And we knew from the very beginning that inclusive economic growth was an important area, and that was a place where we needed to start. And so if we go to the next slide, you'll see what our initial goal was as it related to inclusive economic growth. And our goal was to develop an economic inclusion plan and a procurement policy so that we can promote, elevate, and increase participation of minority-owned and women-owned businesses and city spending. Next slide. And so we started our internal process to really start to examine this. One of the first things that we did was establish an internal economic inclusion task force. And so that task force is made up of several city departments. So it was myself, it was Marsha McGill from the Office of St. Paul's Transformation, it was economic development at the table, as well as procurement at that table originally. We also had input from NRHA as well. So we had this internal group that was really starting to look at what does economic inclusion look like for the city of Norfolk. And then we explored what was already happening in other cities, right? What's happening in cities that are starting to do it well? Don't know many cities that have mastered it, right? But there are cities that are starting to do it well. And so we looked at some of our larger cities. We looked at Chicago. We looked at Philadelphia. We looked at some more mid-sized cities. We looked at Champaign, Illinois, right? And so we talked to folks in those different cities, and we even examined Baltimore, because we had looked at Baltimore as a model as it related to the St. Paul's Transformation Project. And really tried to look at what they had done, what strategies they had put in place, what policy requirements they put in place to help us in establishing our own. And then where we spent a significant amount of time was researching the 2018 Virginia Beach Disparity Study. And so if we go to the next slide, we just pulled out one component from that Virginia Beach Disparity Study that really looks at how they got to the place of establishing two of their aspirational goals. Virginia Beach has an aspirational goal for minority-owned businesses at 12% and a goal for women-owned businesses at 13.3%. I want to make one note. They highlight white women-owned businesses, and for them that means non-Hispanic white women-owned. For us, what we're presenting to you is just for women-owned businesses at 13%. And minority-owned businesses at 12%. But using their research and their findings as support for why we are bringing forth the goals that we have today. Now, what we know from the Virginia Beach Disparity Study is that when they were doing their research, they weren't just looking at companies that exist within Virginia Beach. We know that our metropolitan statistical area, includes much of Hampton Roads, right? And so we have folks that live in our city, operate businesses in our city or in our supportive cities, right? And so when we look at our MSA, we're represented in the disparity study that was done in Virginia Beach. And so this disparity study, we're able to use that as the legal basis for us to move forward. And one thing I just want to add, we have had Andy Fox serve as our city attorney on this. And so this was done under the recommendation with the support from the city attorney's office to make sure that we were within our legal right to move forward with what we did. And so we used the Virginia Beach Disparity Study as our basis and our documentation and our support for the work that we're bringing to you guys today. And if we go to the next slide. Our recommendation that you're going to see and be voting on next week on December 8th is we want to set aspirational goals for minority-owned businesses and women-owned businesses, and we want to use the results from the Virginia Beach Disparity Study to support that. So a 12% goal across the board for the city and a 13% goal across the board for women-owned businesses. If we go to the next slide, you'll see that when you see the ordinance, you'll see in the ordinance that it goes deeper than just having these aspirational goals. We go into more specifics at really how we start to do that and what the policy side of this looks like. And so one of the great things is having Mike Beavis, our chief procurement officer, involved in this entire process. And what he's going to do now is go into a little more detail about the policy side of it. Mike?
Thank you, Aaliyah, and thank you, everyone, for allowing me to speak today. What I'd like to do is just walk through at a very high level what the ordinance will actually provide us the ability to do. It's important to bear in mind that we can only do what's specifically authorized, right? So we could not set goals ourselves. We could not find vendors to be non-responsive. if they didn't meet those goals without legislation, right, without an ordinance. And the city attorney's office has been great in drafting the ordinance that will be before you. And I just wanted to, like I said, give that high level overview of the tools that that will provide all of the people who are engaged in procurement in the city of Norfolk to pursue these goals. The first thing that you'll see in the ordinance is construction project goals. The ordinance will provide that for those construction projects that are valued over $5 million, there will be specific goals developed. And then the expectation will be that bidders will meet those goals or exceed them. And if they don't, they can be found non-responsive and we can go to the next low bidder. There is a waiver process which requires a number of specific actions to have been taken on behalf of the vendor if they're bidding and they don't meet those goals. And that would have to be determined in the future whether or not they would meet those exclusion criteria or exemption criteria. So that's the big construction projects that would capture many of the construction projects and create the opportunity for those departments that administer those programs to manage compliance from the vendors in a more real manner than just saying, please do this, right? Now we'll have some teeth behind it. For contracts under $5 million, not just construction, but all contracts that are under $5 million, it will give us the ability to establish goals of up to 50%. Now, the reason it's 50% instead of 12% or 13.3% is those two goals, the 12 and the 13, are system-wide, right? So on some projects, we'll have higher compliance, on others, we'll have lower. And that's based on the market's capability to respond based on our analysis. And the next two tools that we'll get will speak specifically to those. So you could change the slide, Ken. So these are sheltered bidding tools that we would have. And what sheltered bidding is we would be able to bid so that only SWAM firms, in other words, small women and minority-owned businesses, would be eligible to bid. So majority firms would not have the opportunity to bid on sheltered bidding projects. One of the tools that we're asking for you to approve for us to use is the ability for us to designate any contract between $25,000 and $5 million as a SWAM sheltered bidding project. That's not saying we'll do it with all of them. Of course, we have to analyze whether the market's capable of handling those projects and how it will work and ensure we're paying a fair price and being responsible with the money. But this would give us the tool to pursue those sheltered bids. And then the final one is something that is new. These other three that we've talked about have been enacted by Virginia Beach. They are tools that are proven across the country to work. They're used in all the cities that Aaliyah mentioned. One thing that was just approved by the legislature in this past session is this idea of a micro business contracting program, which would provide another level of sheltered bidding, but this would be specifically for firms with less than 25 employees. This is new, that's just been authorized by the state, so we've just been given the ability to have it, and we would be leading the way there with these micro businesses. And we think that would have a significant impact on the ability of those micro businesses to grow and be successful in Norfolk. And then you'll see that we're asking for a lower ceiling on those. That's because they're micro businesses, right? We don't want to give them or the ability to get a contract that's so large that, you know, that it could cause them damage in the future, right? We want to make sure that they were growing businesses, not hurting them. So the micro business provides another sheltered bidding opportunity for those specific organizations. And those are the four things that we're asking for. And you'll see that's the ordinance provides the legal language around giving us those permissions. And that enables us then to pursue those specific goals and to build a program using St. Paul's as the test. There will be resources needed to accomplish this. There will be processes put in place, forms created, you know, the entire world of structure will have to be created around this policy. And we're starting that with St. Paul's. And the project has been very engaged in developing these goals and these programs. And we think that that's a place where we can learn and come back to you and tell you what's successful and what isn't. And I think develop a great set of opportunities for the businesses here in Norfolk. And that's my part. We can go to Martha for
the next slide.
Yes, the next slide.
And so once we started to, thank you, Mike. Thank you, Michael. Once we established the policy, we realized that internally we needed to expand our team. And so what you'll see represented here on the screen is from one of our recent meetings. We've expanded our team beyond the initial departments that I mentioned to include the other departments that do procuring out of their own departments. For example, Public Works, Utility, Recreation, Parks, and Open Space, Transit as well. And moving forward, we are also going to add the Office of Resilience to this expanded economic inclusion team, because we recognize that because buying doesn't just happen through the purchasing office, we need all the other departments that do buying to be on board with this and to really for us to all follow a similar process for how we're going to do it. Next slide. And so this is what we're going to talk next about, what our execution looks like, right? So it's one thing for us to have the aspirational goals. The next step is for us to have the policy. But internally, we need to have some checks and balances on how this really gets executed and then measured, right? Because the only thing that's measured is what matters, right? And so we have to be able to measure all of this. And so some of the things that we have discussed and we're going to be moving forward with our city departments is completion and submission of an economic inclusion plan. And so the idea behind that would be that as city departments, as projects are going out to bid, as RFPs are going out, we want departments to start to forecast their future procurement needs. We know that's not always possible, but when we think about the federal government and when the federal government does spending, they acknowledge what they're going to spend in that next year, right? So smaller businesses have a chance to prepare and figure out what opportunities they're going to be able to compete for. And so as much as we can, we want to move in that same direction where we start to forecast opportunities so our smaller companies can get ahead of it and start to do the work they need to do so that they can actually compete. That next step, implementing a debundling program. We know that sometimes contract opportunities are too large for businesses that have smaller capacity. And so if we start to pick apart the opportunity in a way where we create smaller bid packages, so we have smaller companies that can compete on pieces of the work, we have a chance to do more business with our smaller companies, especially our micro businesses that just don't have the capacity for larger projects. If we go to the next slide. And so this is our execution continued. A big part of this, and the only way this becomes something that we're able to really have push forward, is by making sure that we do business outreach and engagement. And we know that we have to tap into communities that have historically felt left out of this process. And so what you'll see in a future slide is a rubric that we've created that can start to move us towards seeing what needs to happen in order for there to be good faith effort that is met, right? We've heard that term in the past. We've done our good faith effort. We've made attempts to do it, and there aren't businesses out there. For us, that's not acceptable, right? And so we're putting this rubric in place so you can start to see what we consider to be acceptable steps that you've taken, acceptable levels of outreach, and what's unacceptable. And then the other piece of that is training and technical assistance. We know that as we look at this through an equity lens, those who need more are getting the additional support. So that means that we have Q&A sessions before a RFP is due or a bid is due, so that our smaller companies and any company has a chance to ask additional questions. We offer government contracting workshops. We offer information and resources around bonding. We know that bonding and insurance has been a hindrance for smaller companies in the past because of the credit requirements related to it. So as much as we can offer training and technical assistance that helps our companies, that's all a part of our economic inclusion plan and our policy moving forward. And then the most important part of this is the documentation and compliance. We want to make sure that as city departments and any external player that is doing business with the city of Norfolk, that they are documenting their efforts and that they are in compliance with the goals that we're putting in place. Next slide. So what we came up with was this economic inclusion rubric that starts to look at what we consider to be acceptable in this process, right? So we've seen other cities just say you have to make a good faith effort. We start to put our good faith effort into specifics, right? So what's unacceptable to us is not reaching out to any technical assistance providers, not reaching out to any diverse organizations. And for the record, we have started to create our own list of who we consider to be diverse organizations, right? And so it's not just those who serve our business community. We're talking about our faith-based community. We're talking about the alumni associations of fraternities and sororities, right? There are diverse organizations that have access to our business community, and we need to make sure that we tap into those folks so that they know about the opportunities that are available in the city of Norfolk. Right, and then also listed under the rubric are information sessions. Have you conducted Q&A sessions? Have you conducted or participated in any government contracting workshops that may be hosted by a partner organization or technical assistance provider? And so this is the rubric that we want to bring forward. We welcome any questions or suggestions related to this. And one additional consideration that we're trying to weave into this is, how do we adequately advertise and allow time for companies to prepare to participate in city procurement opportunities? And so we're trying to figure out, can we put something into the rubric that makes sure that we have an opportunity out on the street long enough, or is there some way for us to measure that? And that's something that we're still working through right now. Next slide. And so one of the great opportunities we have to implement this right away is with our St. Paul's Transformation Project. And so we are really using the St. Paul's Transformation as a pilot for us to really get going with this ASAP. So if council is voting on this next week, right after that, we want to start to put this and start to hold ourselves accountable and everyone else accountable for the goals that we're putting out there. And I want to turn it over now to Marcia McGill, Senior Project Manager for the St. Paul's Transformation, to speak to the pilot piece of this.
Thank you, Aaliyah. As Aaliyah indicated, the St. Paul CNI project makes for an excellent pilot project because it includes construction projects of various size and type, and involves work being led by various city departments, NRHA, and the developer. As we move through the implementation of the economic and community policy as a part of the St. Paul project, it will allow us an opportunity to learn what parts of the building is not part. What you see here are the different construction projects that will be led by city departments and the developer. The city projects are in red and the developer projects are in black. It is our plan to include aspects of our economic inclusion policy in all of the city department construction roles. Even though the city council will not be voting on the policy until next week, two of these projects, the pump station project and the Mid Street and Colby Lane project, have gone out for bid or are in the process of going out for bid. We are still working to add language and aspirational goals to those RFPs through addendums. The departments leading these projects, the Department of Utilities and the Department of Public Works, have been very supportive of this work and have provided great feedback. The McDonald's demolition project would be an excellent opportunity to utilize the shelter bidding policy. This project is estimated to cost around $100,000, and we believe we have a healthy number of SWAM businesses to make for a competitive bid process. So as Mike Davis explained, this would allow us to limit the RFP process to small women-owned business and minority-owned businesses. For the larger department projects, such as the Blue Greenway and Infrastructure Phase 1 and 2 projects, we have already begun to discuss incorporating economic community strategies and specific goals with the departments leading these projects. And we plan to take advantage of the lead time to begin promoting these projects and getting potential bidders prepared. As indicated, the projects in black are the developer's construction projects. And it is the plan to hold the developer to the same construction percentage goals as the city departments. The developer is currently working on their economic inclusion plan, which will outline their strategies to meet these goals. And that plan will be presented to City Council and as a part of a St. Paul agenda item in future meetings. Although what Aaliyah, Mike, and I have shared with you thus far is our work to date, we recognize that there is still plenty to do. So I will turn the presentation back over to Aaliyah so that she can share some of our next steps.
Thank you, okay, sorry about that. And so if we could go to the next slide. And we're reaching the end of this presentation, but we really want to just talk quickly about how we're going to deepen our impact beyond what we've done internally so far. We recognize that in order to do this work well, we now need to have an external group, an advisory group to advise us on how do we do that business outreach and engagement piece and the technical assistance and support for our business community. And so we want to reach out to our local business owners, reach out to residents and our technical assistance providers, as well as some of those diverse organizations as well. We want to utilize technical resources to help us moving forward. So the electronic bill pay, electronic procurement platform helps with that. And as a follow-up to our startup in residence, we will have our small business resource website that will be another tool that we'll be able to use. Businesses will be able to go on there, add their information so we know the services that they provide and we can connect them with the opportunities that we will have available. And then also engaging our public and private resource partners. Those folks can help us identify business owners that we may not have had access to or even thought about as we're going through this process. They can provide technical assistance, and they can also distribute and provide access to other opportunities that may exist outside of the city. And so thank you all for your time, and we welcome any questions from everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Aaliyah. Thank you, Marcy. Thank you, Michael. Okay, Mr. Riddick is coming on. All right, Ms. Graves.
Hello.
Mr. Riddick.
So,
Hello. Mr. Riddick? Mr. Riddick?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay. I am here.
Thank you, Mr. Riddick. Good. All right, Ms. Graves?
So I am super excited about this because it has been the subject of conversation since we started the St. Paul's Quadrant transformation. And Susan and Marcia have done an outstanding job in working with our master developers and pushing this effort forward. And so I'm really happy to see it spilling over into all areas of the city. I had a couple of things, and do we currently know, Aaliyah, what how much we spend with SWAM businesses now? Is that a number that we have?
We don't know throughout the entire city. We know for 2020 so far what we've been able to do just through the purchasing department.
Okay.
We don't have it in public works, utilities, and all the other departments. And so we don't have a full number that represents everything that's been done in the city.
Okay, I think that that's a good place to start to see where we are. And that to me helps to establish a baseline. And then one of the other things that you said, I totally agree with, and that is that the process needs to be consistent from department to department and not just disjointed. You do it one way with this department and another way with that department. People who are small business owners, they don't have time for all that. They need to know what is the requirement? How do I meet the requirement? And then what is the assistance that the city can offer? And that kind of leads me to my third point in terms of we had this conversation in the St. Paul's Quadrant in making the paperwork as easy to fill out and maneuver through. Some of this stuff I understand we have to have like some legal disclosures or whatever, but some of it you need to either have a Juris Doctorate or a PhD to be able to understand and read. And when you are a small business owner, you just don't have time to go through and figure out all of that or hire somebody to do it. So I hope that when we start looking at whatever the application process is, that while we need to check off all the legal boxes, that we just don't overload it with so many overlays that it makes it, you know, too cumbersome and difficult to fill out. And then my last thing is, are we developing a list of services that the city needs so that people will know what if I have, for lack of a better example, if I have a business installing motion hand soap dispensers, right? Does the city even need that? So I think that might be helpful in, you know, helping people to understand what's needed, also what we have available for minority contracts, so that if somebody's looking at starting a business, that might be something that will incline them to go in one direction versus the other direction because they might be able to get a city contract.
If I could speak to the questions, thank you very much, Councilwoman Graves, for all of that. I just want to speak to the last part of what you said. One of the things that we did institute about a year ago between Mike Beavis and our Economic Development Department was a reverse vendor fair. So the various departments that do small spending within their own department, they were able to come and demonstrate and show what they normally purchase, whether that's paper, whether that's food for meetings or whatever it may be. So then our smaller businesses were able to see from city departments what they spend money on. And so they were able to make a connection that way. But I definitely think we can expand that and do more with it. So thank you.
Cool, thank you.
One other thing, if I may, the when we shifted to electronic commerce for our bids and RFP submittals, part of the platform that we're using now creates the opportunity where, first off, we re-examined all the forms we're using to make sure they were the minimum we needed. And the way the system works now is a vendor only has to fill them out once, and they basically stay filled out, and then they can resubmit them over and over again. So we're working hard to make it easier to do business with us. And that's one of our goals across the board.
Cool beans, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Ms. McClellan.
First of all, thank you, Angela. I was gonna ask the same in terms of our baseline. So we haven't done a disparity study on our end. We're just gonna use the Virginia Beach information. Is that correct, what I heard, Aaliyah?
Yes, ma'am, that's correct.
Okay. So go ahead, Michael.
One of the challenges we have, which we don't have a clear answer to, yes, is utilization of subcontractors.
Mm-hmm.
Right, that we can work. We're starting to work with our spend data right now to identify the prime contractors, which are SWAM certified. Right? And we can do that, but to get below that to the subs, that data isn't in a currently accessible form.
Right. Right.
It will be in the future, but not yet.
And we can't go through the Commissioner of Revenue's office. They can't give us that information, as I understood it.
They don't track that well, I don't know what they track, but the information we're using, we're cross-referencing with the state SWAM certification programs.
Right.
And that's where we're doing the cross-referencing.
So Michael, that's a good segue to my next question is SWAM versus DBE. Mm-hmm. And how are we defining what's small? Women and minority, I'm not sure there's a state definition of that, but you know, for our goals of diversity, equity, inclusion, not all small businesses will hit those goals necessarily. Could we talk about that?
Yes, one of the goals we have, and you'll see this in some of our outreach materials, is we want to help businesses be as successful as possible. So we will support businesses getting SWAM certified by the state, because that will give them automatic certification for a number of jurisdictions, for a number of opportunities, right? So we'll be looking towards that as a first step. Plus we have independent verification of who they are, right? We don't have the problem of us judging badly. Right? So that gives an advantage both to the organization and to us. And in addition, they can get on other bid lists and other program lists, and we try to help them not only get business with us, but get business with Virginia Beach or whoever else has got something in their area. And we have assisted in helping people find those opportunities. As it relates to the micro businesses, that's new. We'll be working on how we develop that process and how we identify who the micro businesses are, you know, whether it's a self-certification or we need to do some checking, or you know, how that process is going to work. So that one is still being developed. In fact, a lot of this is going to be developed once you all give us the authority to do it, right?
The last question I had, well, there's one comment, the question though first, the outreach and information sessions that you have in there, the 5-4-3-2-1, because we're in COVID, I'm assuming that you're gonna allow for some of this to be done virtually?
Oh, absolutely, yes.
Just wanted to make sure that, because obviously be constrained. And then will there be some sort of annual reporting mechanism back to council so we can see the progress?
Yes, that's part of our next steps. Once you guys vote on this and we move forward, we will put something in place so that we have more regular reporting from the departments, and then we'll come back to council on a whether it's an annual or biannual basis, and let you guys know where we are, where we found hiccups, where we found challenges, where we had to be agile and adjust. And so that's our plan, definitely.
Okay. And I was just going to say, I'm sure you're already working with the chamber.
Yes.
This obviously on a regional basis. That's great. Thank you for your efforts. It's wonderful.
Thank you.
Are there others?
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Ms. Johnson.
Hi, thank you. Thank you, Ms. Slappy. It's Slappy Wilson. So thank you, Ms. Slappy Wilson, for your and your team's effort in trying to bring this about the city. I just have a couple of questions as well as a few comments. And I think both of my colleagues, Mrs. Graves and Mrs. McCullen, touched on a lot of what I wanted to say. But one of the things when we were working on Open Norfolk, and we were trying to identify small businesses, one of the things that we found is that the city does not have an accurate listing of all of the small businesses in the city of Norfolk. So Mel Price and I, we're working on Open Norfolk, and I say to Mel, hey Mel, are you aware of this business? I said, is this business on your list? She says, no, I never heard of it. I said, I know. So we actually went to visit some of the small businesses that were not on her list so that they could become a part of the first phase of Open Norfolk with bringing out outdoor dining. So I see that that is a gap. And we found, and I noticed that if some of the small businesses are not a part of a business association, then the city does not know that these small businesses exist. So I don't know possibly where the gap is, because I know that the small businesses have to apply for business licenses. However, there isn't this master list of all of the small businesses in our city. So how could your team, I know you're really excited about small businesses, but we're missing a lot of them. So
I'm ready to, the smile on my face is, it's almost like you asked a question I was ready to answer. So thank you. So one of the things, the same way that you and Mel Price found that situation, we found that situation among our team. Even looking at lists that we have through economic development or through different departments, and even comparing that list to what NRHA has on their Section 3 business list, right? And so we found that there were all these lists floating around, and it wasn't a master list, right? And so what we've done with our startup and resident small business website that we're developing, we ask them to add on there a component where a business can, we say to all our businesses, this is going to be a campaign we're working on with Lori Crouch and our communications team. We want to hear from you. We want to know the services that you offer. So essentially, they will go onto our site that will live on the Norfolk.gov platform, and they can upload information about who they are, their address, their and details about their business. So we start to build our own list, right? Because we have lists that are tied to business associations, to Black Brand, the African American Chamber, the Hispanic Chamber. We have all these different lists and different groups. We don't have that master list. And so that's a gap that we have identified. And we recognize that the only way that we start to build the master list is to build it ourselves, right? Rather than kind of depending on all the external lists. And part of the goal will be that from all of those various lists, we'll send something out and say, hey, we need you to come over to this side, add your information, so we have your latest, most up-to-date information. And so from there, we can start to send information out to folks. But that is something that we found very early on, and we realized that that was a hole in the system, that no other city has like this master list either, right, where they're able to get at everyone. And if someone isn't SWAM certified, they're not going to show up on the state's list as well. And so that's something that we have found and that we're working to address.
And my last question is, when you mentioned about the workshops and training that you're going to be offering to small business owners or people who are really interested in procurement and things like that, one of the things that the council really wanted to see change was everybody does not work a 9-to-5 job. And so somehow we need to figure out how could we possibly also offer the workshops and the training in the evenings and on Saturdays to get the entire city involved in what you're trying to do.
Absolutely, we agree. And we refer to some of those folks as the 2 a.m. entrepreneur, our non-traditional entrepreneur, and finding ways that we address them. And so we are looking into that. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Slappy Wilson.
Okay. Are there others?
Hey, quick question.
Yes, Ms. Gray.
I have a quick question. Is it possible, Aaliyah, to be able to coordinate with the Commissioner of Revenue's office when businesses open in Norfolk? I mean, I know we're working on the ones that are already existing, but like when businesses open in Norfolk to have a box, or they have to go online and apply for their license. I just went through this process. And there's a number of benefits that are being offered currently. Is it possible that there could be a box on the business license application form that links directly to your office that they can check and say, please include us in the small, or do you want to be included in the small business directory if you meet X, Y, and Z criteria? You know, like once you decide what the criteria is for small business, if you meet this criteria, would you like to be included? And then they can check the box. And then once their license is actually issued, it automatically will put them on your database and add them to your radar.
We can definitely look into that, follow up with the Commissioner of Revenue. Thank you.
Are there others? Okay. Well, if not, thank you, Aaliyah. Thank you, Marcia. And thank you, Michael.
Thank you. All right. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Aaliyah. I want to thank that whole team for all the great work that they've done. I really want to thank the council members for some great feedback. As we mentioned, you'll see the specific language come to you all during next week. And I really want to put an exclamation point on something that Councilwoman Graves was alluding to. I think, we've got a lot of big projects happening across the city, and I think those will get the headlines, and we'll talk about inclusion in those projects and so on and try to meet goals in those projects. But let's not miss the fact that a lot of these young firms need some opportunity. And that's really all they need to grow. And we have, on an annual basis, a massive amount of procurement that we do through this city in a number of different areas. And I really think the sweet spot for what we're working on here, particularly being the first out of the gate in the state with a micro business program, is to really focus in on helping provide those opportunities. And I think Mike Beavis and his team have done a wonderful job with some of these reverse vendor programs to try and get that started. And I think this gets us over the top. And I think really where we'll see the payoff to this program down the road is in just getting companies engaged with us on the stuff that we do each and every year. So thank council members for all their feedback, and look forward to getting that through next week. All right, next. It's been a while since we've come to you with an update on the Ohio Creek project. It is well underway. If you have not driven out through Chesterfield Heights recently, you will notice some very massive changes to the topography of the area. All of this with the grand goal of keeping this neighborhood relevant and resilient for the next, say, 100 years, right? And it's moving along very well. I personally want to thank Doug Beaver and his team for all the work they're doing. Remember that while they are juggling a multi-million dollar project, we're also trying to accomplish some other things with resilience across the city. So, Doug is really putting in overtime quite a bit. But I thought it was a great opportunity before the holidays here to bring Doug in, give us an update on the project, show you some pictures of what's going on out there, and talk about the next steps. So, Doug, I see Doug. Doug, whenever you're ready, thanks for being here.
Thank you, Dr. Filer, and good afternoon, Mayor Alexander, Vice Mayor Thomas, and members of City Council. Like Dr. Filer just mentioned, it was this past July, I had an opportunity to provide an update on the project where we were going through a number of significant road closures. The good news is we continue to make significant strides and meet all of our milestones on the project, and I want to outline a few of those this evening. Here we go. So just as a quick overview of the project, it really boils down to three main areas. We're looking at coastal protection, stormwater management, and the resilience park. So starting left to right on the slide, Kimball Terrace has been built up, and we're just allowing that settlement to occur before we actually start more work on that area north of the Titan property near Ohio Creek. And as you work your way left to right, there'll be an open title exchange into the Ohio Creek, followed by a coastal protection flood wall along the Jim Gunn property, and then a tidal gate protecting the Haynes Creek area and the Haynes Creek pump station to the north. Working your way down to the southern portion toward the Elizabeth River, you're going to have a berm that we are in construction right now, which I'll show you a few pictures of here in a moment, and then a Ballantyne pump station at the southern end of Ballantyne Boulevard to include a fishing pier on the southern portion of that, and then the berm will continue along toward the Grandy Village Learning Center and then up towards the Resilience Park. And we're doing a lot of work around Chesterfield Academy right now, which I'll show a picture up here in a minute. So as you are well aware, with this picture right here, we started construction in mid-January, and we had a groundbreaking just on the backside of the Grandy Village Rec Center. And you can see that area is now in full force construction of the Resilience Park. You can start to see the berm construction on the western side of the park and some of the other features that will be an amenity for the community. So in the first 10 months, we've expended over $40 million on this project. So we're about a third of the way done as far as expenditures and as far as timeline. So we're on track to be complete by December of 2022, which when I first came to you back in January, we were looking to be complete in April of 2023. So this gets us closer to substantially complete by September. And I'll update you on a few initiatives we have with regard to extending that time to help us close out the grant with the Commonwealth of Virginia as the prime recipient. Here's a picture of over the Elizabeth River facing north in the background of Norfolk State. In the foreground, you have a rock sill, which has been completed, and a rock revetment. What I want to highlight here is, as you look on the eastern side, we are right up against the residents of Marlborough Avenue and Chesterfield Boulevard, right up to the fence line, which is where the berm will grow. And we've had to address some community concerns, which I'll talk to more fully in a slide later. But we are 90%, that's the good news, is we're 90% complete with this rock sill and rock revetment. So the last steps, which will occur in the following year, is the actual construction of the berm. Here's a picture looking south over Marlborough Avenue and then down Majestic Avenue toward Chesterfield Boulevard on the left and right. The contractor's done a really good job of, when we're building these rock sills and rock berms, bringing the rocks in on barges to alleviate any further truck traffic, because as you can see, there are multiple roads under construction simultaneously, and that was all phased into the project to ensure we completed our substantial completion by September of 2022. Some of the next steps, and one that we just recently accomplished, we were planning on 4 contract amendments as funds became available. We added an additional one here within the past 2 months, and that allowed us to bring forward some of the pump station components from the Ballantyne pump station, which we were looking to procure in July of next year. We brought them forward because they're long lead times given the some of the effects of the pandemic right now. So that allows us more flexibility and allows us to stay either on or ahead of timeline. One additional thing is we were able to add back in a 3-hoop junior basketball court into the park. And so we were just out there the other day. I have a picture with the principal of Chesterfield Academy here in a minute. But to add that amenity back into the park was I consider a substantial win with that additional money available as we did that contract amendment. One of the challenges we continue to work through due to the pandemic is relocation assistance for several renters and families who are in the project area. That was put on hold when the pandemic started. We have reinvigorated and restarted that process, but just given the nature of having to meet certain HUD requirements for the relocation of these families, we're being diligent to ensure that we don't put somebody in a position where, with moving companies now maybe pulling back based on this third surge of the pandemic, we don't want to put anybody in a position that's uncomfortable. So we will continue to work with those families. It has not negatively impacted our schedule yet, but it's one of those things that we're tracking very closely. And lastly, I mentioned we've been working with the seven other states and five other localities on a three-year extension. The three-year time frame was mainly driven from some of the other grant recipients. And that's due to the fact that we are probably in the top third as far as expenditure of funds of all of those localities and states. So we don't necessarily need a three-year extension, but this is a coalition of all 13 entities. So this will allow us to close out the grant. We don't think we're going to need anywhere near that time extension. But who would have predicted a pandemic in 2020? Who would have predicted more name storms and hurricanes in history? So having that buffer on the back end will allow us more flexibility. Community engagement continues to be a key aspect of what we're doing in the Office of Resilience. All the in-person Civic League meetings for the Chesterfield Heights and Grandy Village communities were suspended in March, although we continued to meet individually with the leadership of those Civic Leagues through the pandemic. It's just made it more difficult. We've had we've gone to more virtual and one-on-one interaction. We continue to send out quarterly newsletters and where we highlight our Section 3 opportunities, which I have another slide on here in a minute, and I'll talk to you further. And then our Deputy Resilience Officer, Kyle Spencer, also went to a MyNorfolk event in person that was talking about the MyNorfolk app, but also since they were residents of that community, an opportunity to provide a face-to-face update on the significant amount of work going on in their neighborhoods. And like I mentioned earlier, here's a picture from last month where we met with Michelle Logan, who's the principal, and the vice principal, Sally Adams. You're looking at the junior playground, which we really leaned forward on with the fact that they weren't doing in-person learning for the first quarter of school and now for the first semester of school, to really try to button up all those amenities so when the kids do come back in person, they have some outdoor activities. So we actually redesigned one of the fence lines around the basketball court based on some of the concerns that they had. So we really had we've been pleased to have some face-to-face interaction with the community leadership and to hear their feedback as we go through construction. We also just sent out a traffic mailer the other day. There's gonna be some continued road closures along Majestic Avenue and Norchester. We had a virtual Civic League meeting last night with over a dozen Chesterfield Heights community members. And got a lot of feedback from them. There was concerns about traffic signage, about which roads are closed, which roads are open. There was concerns about Marlboro Avenue. We are going to be putting down a more substantial undercoating of that before we go to final paving here in the next 3 weeks, which I think will address a lot of their concerns. But it was a very good interaction. We'll continue to do that virtually until we can go back to face-to-face Civic League meetings. And then, as I mentioned, we've had a lot of one-on-one interaction throughout the last 10 months with a number of residents, in particular along Chesterfield Boulevard here. As you can see, there's heavy excavators that have been placing the rock sill and rock revetment, and that's led to some of the concerns about vibration as these heavy tracked vehicles go east and west along the shoreline there. And in some areas, it's very close to the road. And so we met back in August with the president of the Chesterfield Heights Community Civic League. And based on that feedback, I directed another inspector be specifically put in that area for 90 days while that significant construction happened. And so that was able to have a significant impact immediately on their concerns, and they were appreciative of that. We did have another opportunity last week where the Public Works construction manager, Sayla Chivani, and the supervisor of the subcontractor went out and met with the president of the Civic League as well to talk about what's going on. But as you can see, most of the work is done. As I mentioned, it's 90% complete. There are some areas where we're still going to have to put in the rock revetment, but the majority of the construction where the heavy excavators are going to be traveling along the shoreline there is complete. And lastly, I want to talk about our hiring section three. To date, we have had three resident and contractor mixers and one bidders workshop that have been held in the last 2 years. We were planning on having another mixer when the pandemic hit. So we've had to go on to a more aggressive online via the newsletter, via email, as well as the construction subcontractor with NEB has put out 38 Section 3 job advertisements in the past 10 months to the residents of both Chesterfield Heights and Granny Village. That has led to 23% of new hires coming from those communities in general contracting and masonry. There's been one significant contract with a local hauling operation who also does some facility relocation to the tune of about $200,000+ for relocating a storage facility on the near the Titan property, as well as continued hauling operations. As you can see, there's a lot of material moving around the community, and those hauling operations will continue throughout the next 2 years. So we think that figure will continue to increase as more opportunities become available. And with that, I'll pause and be happy to answer your questions at this point.
Okay, thank you, Kevin Beaver. Questions for
So I just have a quick one, Doug. Thank you for the update. It's excellent. I'm just so thrilled to see this transformation take place. Given its current state, how did Chesterfield Heights weather the most recent storms, high tides, et cetera, based on what was built?
Yes, ma'am. Great question. As a matter of fact, the photos that I showed you are taken weekly by our contractor. And what I've asked is for them not only to be date stamped, but time stamped. So I can measure those again. What's the tidal cycle? Are we having a nor'easter? Are we having a coastal storm? So we just started instituting that, and I don't have the data yet. I haven't done the math and the homework to put those two data points together. The biggest impact we saw, and I got some pictures from some of the residents, in particular along Marlboro Avenue in their backyards, was the ponding that's occurring. Because as we build this, we have to continue to increase the stormwater capacity so that ponding doesn't happen. So we've had to sort of an educational piece of it's not going to pond there eventually. But as we've seen throughout the community, some of these, and we'll see this in the future, some of these increased duration frequency rainstorms, you will see ponding in areas you may have not seen in the past. But I hope that addresses your question.
It does. And I think documenting like you are is going to be important to show the success in the design and the work that your team has put forward that will obviously then help other parts of the city. So thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Riddick, did you have something?
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, Mr. Riddick, go right on.
Mr. Mayor?
Mr. Riddick?
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, Mr. Riddick. Mr. Riddick, I can hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, Mr. Riddick. Go right on.
Can I cancel about this?
Yes.
A little puppy face. First of all, let me ask Doug a couple of questions.
Yes, go ahead, Mr. Riddick.
Okay. Doug, will the swimming pool be affected at all?
No, sir. We are operating outside of the fence line of the swimming pool. As you're well aware, it was not open this past summer. There is construction going on the south side of it and the east side of it. Part of the design of the basketball courts was to have vehicular traffic be able to get to the pool to service it. So as far as inside the fence line of the pool, there's nothing going on in this project inside the fence line. Everything's going on the outside, and we are taking into account eventually needing to have access as well for pedestrians and patrons, as well as service vehicles.
The basketball court again for me.
I'm sorry, can you repeat the question?
Basketball court. Speak to the basketball court.
Basketball courts, how will they be affected?
So there's going to be a, they will not be affected by any of the, what's happening in the pool. So we're going to have two basketball courts right up against adjacent to Chesterfield Academy. And then where we had the groundbreaking, we're going to have basketball courts put right back in that same spot.
Okay. Will patrons be able to walk from Chesterfield Boulevard to Waterside?
They will, there's not a new path along the shoreline. They will have to use the same route that they currently use right now, which is to go up to Kimball Terrace and then head east towards the Resilience Park. When they get to the Ballantyne Pump Station at the southern end of Ballantyne and in Kimball Loop and Kimball Terrace, they will be able to go south to the fishing pier from there, but nothing along the shoreline is planned at this point.
Nothing along Chesterfield Boulevard.
Correct. There's no paths along there. The berm is going to be constructed between Chesterfield Boulevard and the shoreline, but there are no paths along the berm itself.
You know, this was a fight 10 years ago with the residents on Chesterfield Boulevard. They just wanted to give the city the right to entry to come in and do whatever work they needed to do. But our city attorney's office fought the community. And I still believe there is room for a class action suit for at least $15 million against the city for taking property that belonged to the residents along Chesterfield Boulevard.
Councilman Riddick, my understanding, and I'll defer to the city attorney's office.
Because you weren't out here. But I have been intricately involved with that, and it's not over yet.
Councilman Riddick, I will work with the city attorney's office. My understanding that that property was looked at prior to or during the design and planning stage, but I'm happy to work with the city attorney's office to look at that material again.
Yeah, what happened, they created some type of, I don't know, I can't think of the word, organization to represent the community, and then muscle the property community. But as long as you know what you need to do, this is something that will happen later on.
Okay. All right. Any other questions or comments or remarks for Doug Beaver? Okay. Dr. Filer.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Doug. Appreciate it. Appreciate all the good work. Okay, we've got some colder temps. Obviously, today is a lot colder than it's been, so the timing on this is pretty good. I know council members, I believe several of you have asked me in our one-on-ones and even in council meetings previously, what's our plan for Nest? Nest is one of the most important programs that we run through the winter season to help with our homeless population and keeping them safe. I know with COVID, we've got a unique circumstance this year. I know many of you have been asking and wondering, you know, what is our plan? So I felt like with the impending colder temperatures coming, it's a good opportunity to bring Deputy City Manager James Rogers and Sarah Fuller with CSB in to talk you all through how we're going to manage to get through in the COVID environment. The good news is we have a plan. The great news is just massive amounts of thanks to some of the community partners that are going to really lean in hard and help us out in this unique circumstance. So with that, sir, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Rogers and Sarah.
Good evening, Mayor, Vice Mayor, Council members, and City Manager Dr. Fowler. We appreciate the opportunity to provide you an update on the Norfolk Emergency Shelter Team operation,
or what we refer to as NEST. I will start by acknowledging the great coordination work for the NEST program by Sarah Fuller and her incredible staff at the Community Service Board in collaboration with our partners, who are an integral part of the fabric that is woven together to provide a safety net for the most vulnerable in our community. As you can imagine, NEST during this pandemic would not be sustainable without the partners that include Southeastern Virginia Continuum of Care, Norfolk Public Health, Human Services, Sentara Health, Union Mission, Salvation Army, 4Kids, LGBT Life Center, the YMCA, EOC, and the Norfolk Police Department. What Councilmember Johnson would call the boots on the ground. This group also includes the faith community, whom you will hear us often refer to as the trusted partners. I want to pivot a bit and really provide you with some background and some challenges that we've had. Due to what is characterized by Deputy City Manager Mike Goldsmith as a persistent threat caused by COVID-19, we understood that our efforts to provide NEST programming in a safe manner this winter would require us to cooperate and operate differently. First and foremost, we knew that many churches that had previously served as NEST host sites would not be available. Many of them have been closed for months, and so they would not be available. Also, there would be a limited volunteer base due to many volunteers being susceptible to COVID-19 as a result of their age or underlying health condition. So let me frame our current and then ongoing efforts as I go forward. The CSB began daily hotel housing program this summer to support about 120 folks in their hotels. This initiative currently provides homeless adults who are most vulnerable to the health effects of COVID-19 with a safe on-site access to medical services, COVID testing, intensive support service. At that site, at those hotel sites, we wrap around all the necessary services that they need because we have them in one stable location where we can actually put our hands on them every day. Also, we've talked to Sentara, and they love this model as well because now they don't have to go find or people have to come to the emergency room. They can find them and have that medical service right at the hotel, which is just fabulous for us. So as we looked at, we are currently not only doing this work, but Union Mission Ministries, Salvation Army, Ghent Area Ministries, and the Norfolk members of the Continuum of Care have also collaborated to provide hotel accommodations, rapid rehousing, and other support to individuals and families. Just to add some context, the 120 people that we normally have that I mentioned that are in the Safe Hotels program, that is equal to the number of people that on a daily basis with NEST under the old model, where we would actually have them come down to the Human Services building, take a ticket, take a number, and then we would actually bus them somewhere. So we are actually housing all of those folks in our hotels. That leaves us about 40 more people that we still have to find places for. So that will require us to have that NEST that we've been talking about. So what we've done is, as always, talking to this faith-based communities, and as we talk about these partners as well, there's always a call to action. And so what we've done is call the action and say, look, we need your help And fortunately for us, one of our trusted partners, First Presbyterian Church, led by Pastor Wood, offered to host NEST at his facility for the first 6 weeks of NEST. That's a remarkable event or a remarkable outpouring of help from the community. That will give us some leeway to actually build some capacity with other churches as well. That service will actually begin tomorrow night starting at 6:30 p.m. Also want to note that this is normally this time period, we start in November to March. That's the season for NEST. So I was amazed. We knew we needed additional partners. Again, we put the call to action out, and I've learned yesterday that there are several more churches that have raised their hands and said, yes, we will be partners with this NEST program. And so what we're doing is during this six-week period, they will come alongside Pastor Wood and his team at First Presbyterian, see how all of this works, and understand so when it's their week, and they've committed to taking a week at a time, so this will actually help us get us through this period. But this was not the end of our need. As always, many of you understand that once folks leave NEST in the evening or in the morning, they would generally go to a library, go to a rec center, or possibly to a business. But again, we asked to call the action, and another faith partner raised a hand, which is New Hope Church of God in Christ, led by Pastor Calvin Duren, said, I will provide the day services. So once those folks leave NEST, those 30, 40 or so people leave NEST, he will be able to offer those folks showers, food, clothing, shelters right in place at his location. We've also working with HRT to make sure we have bus passes so folks can be transferred so they can move around. So again, this has just been remarkable what the community has said, I will raise my hand and I will participate to help this get done. CSB and EOC team is working with New Hope to solidify how we do all this stuff safely. And so they will be on site this week putting all that together. In closing, I must continue to note that this will be a year that has a reduced number of shelters available at any given time. That's that 40 or so that we will have. But the CSB and our NEST partners will continue to work together to address the need to provide safe shelter for additional persons as the evenings we have a more extreme weather. The ongoing thing I want to make sure that we looked at, this is not the end of what we're going to be doing. This year we've been focused on how can we get those 120, 130 people somewhere where they'll be safe. We know where they are. We don't have to look for them. And so we've done that. And so, again, we're going to continue to work that way. But we're also going to have, we still have these multiple volunteers in the faith base that are providing meals all the time. Mercy Chef. They're providing medical treatment, case management, all of those things that will help us mitigate this issue. So I just want to just also, the city manager, as he often does, challenges us to do a longer term look at this. So what we want a longer term to do look at is to really provide permanent housing for these folks. And so what we're doing is we're actively looking for a location where we'll be able to have permanent housing for this, because we've known, talking to folks like List and talking to Hampton Roads Foundation, also to the Centura Foundation, that when you do that, folks will come and possibly help you fund these activities. So again, I'm encouraged, despite the challenges, that NEST team and the community partners are committed to protecting the persons who live outside during this winter, as well as the COVID. I'm so inspired by the community partnerships to answer the call to action, no matter what we ask. And lastly, I really want to thank the mayor, this city council. Every turn where we've asked for your support, you've given it. You've reached out to your folks that you have in the community and say, hey, look, we need to help, and they've come to answer. So I really just wanted to thank everyone for all their efforts. And again, a real hat off to Sarah and her team who does this work every day. And with that, I'll stop talking and ask any questions that you have.
Thank you, Mr. Rogers. Any questions for Mr. Rogers or
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, Ms. Johnson.
I would just like to say...
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Riddick, hold on a second, Mr. Riddick. Go ahead, Ms. Johnson, go ahead and finish.
I would just like to say...
Hey, James, can you hear me?
Ms. Johnson?
It's my turn?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. I would just like to say thank you to Mr. James Rogers, Sarah Fuller, and the entire Team Norfolk for what you do for this NEST program, and for all of the partners in our city who are willing to partner with the city of Norfolk. You are making a great impact on people's lives. Mr. Rogers, to Mercy Chef, I can say to my colleagues, if you have never had the opportunity to sit down for a meal that Mercy Chef has created, you're missing out on something. Mercy Chef goes across the United States as well as international to serve people who are in need of hunger. That is their specialty. And I was very fortunate to partner with Mercy Chef to feed the children and families in the greater Broad Creek area for 3 years at the Broad Creek Summer Camp. So thank you, Mr. Rogers. Thank you to my colleagues. And thank you, Mr. Mayor and Mr. Manager.
Okay, Mr. Riddick. Mr. Riddick? Mr. Riddick? Mr. Riddick? Okay, we'll come back. Ms. Doyle, we'll come back to Mr. Riddick.
I just want to thank Sarah Fuller. Sarah, you were really great. You responded to a concern from a community member about a homeless population in a part of the city. And you responded so quickly, and you literally have done what James was actually saying. You've housed these people. They are in a shelter. They have a roof over their head tonight, and they'll be able to head to NEST tomorrow. But I just appreciate it. I mean, I literally was on an email today with Sarah where she is literally saying what James is exactly talking about. So this is happening actively as we speak. So I just want to say thank you.
Thank you. And I want to recognize my team. No, I can let you guys know what they're doing, but they're the true heroes out there.
Okay. Thank you, Sarah. Thank you, Mr. Rogers, for all you do.
Thank you for all you do.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir. Thanks, James, thank you, Sarah, your whole team at CSB.
Mr. Riddick, Mr. Rogers, come on, Mr. Riddick.
The only thing I'd like to say is, and I don't know how this will go over, impact on certain communities, but the Frank Spicer building, it's a very large building, and it could, take care of a lot of the needs for individuals, but the problem is that it will continue to grow and people from other cities will come.
Councilman Redding.
The Spicer building is a building that's there. We have that large, it's just a clear space across the street from it. So if somebody would just look at the Spicer building and just see if there was any impact there.
Yeah, Councilman Riddick, this is Chip. I know you brought this up before as well, and we hear you loud and clear. The Spicer building won't work. I mean, we do have another possible development going on with the Spicer building. However, what you heard James and Sarah allude to about this sort of more permanent, what I think, and Sarah can correct me if I'm wrong, since she's the expert in this place and I only play one on TV. I think the idea here is to create a transitional housing, a more permanent transitional housing solution. Okay. We're sort of using the hotel as that right now, and we'll be able to do that through the pandemic. However, at the end of that, I think we would love to find a facility, sir, exactly like what you're talking about,
right,
somewhere within the city that creates a transitional opportunity for folks that need a little bit more support but can also transition into you know, their own out of the hotel living. So we are looking at
that.
Thank
you.
Thank you
very much.
Okay, Mr. Riddick, thank you. All right, Dr. Feiler.
All right. Moving on to Pete Burek, is here tonight with Civic Lab, and then Fraser Picard, who's our chief information officer. We've come to you guys several times over the past, eight or 9 months since we've been dealing with the pandemic, talking about the broadband access, how we were trying to create some Wi-Fi hotspots throughout the city so that folks could get access to it. One of the questions that came up, and I believe it was from Councilwoman McClellan, was regarding not just simply where these hotspots are, but, you know, what is our actual coverage in the city, and what's the demand for broadband access. And so Pete and Fraser have been able to go through the data and are here tonight to present you the results of our findings. Pete, I see Fraser.
Dr. Feiler, I'm here, but for some reason I'm not getting the option for video. Can everyone hear me?
Yeah, we can see the presentation,
okay.
And I can hear you.
Okay, great.
So I think we're all right.
Okay,
but
sounds great. All right,
sorry,
thank you, everyone.
Can't see you because you know you always look great, and so you know.
Well, thank you. Rest assured, I am dressed for city council here at the other end. So I will do a voiceover, and if it comes back, great. But if not, I will continue through. Good evening, Mayor Alexander and members of council. Dr. Fryer, thank you. This is going to be a co-presentation. I'm going to start off, and then I'm going to turn it over to Fraser Picard, our chief information officer, to talk about things in his world. We've been working collaboratively on this for a long time. And so we're excited to give you an update and answer some of the questions that council members have asked us previously about the state of internet access in Norfolk. Next slide, please. So just to frame this conversation a bit, I think there's really no doubt that in the 21st century economy, fast, reliable internet is a must-have. We really need to shift thinking as a society, thinking of internet access from an amenity to really more of a utility, something that everyone has to have, and that the public has some, the public sector has some role in providing. And we'll get into that here in a little bit. And during this past many months of the pandemic, really the need for internet access, both to support education and employment, has just accelerated and amplified and made this so much more of a critical issue. And there's issues of digital equity to consider here. Those who need access to the internet the most, in a lot of cases, do not have the means in which to pay for the subscriptions. And so we acknowledge that, and there are some things that we're doing in the city to help with that. Next, please. So some of the key questions that we hope to inform you this evening. Generally, what is the state of household internet service in Norfolk? And I'll describe that to you. Identify where there are gaps in coverage and where those are. It's not just enough to describe the challenge. We want to communicate to you how we're helping to fill those gaps and bring new technologies that are coming down the commercial pipe to Norfolk. And Fraser's going to tell you some about that. Next, please. So Virginia Tech does a great job on an ongoing basis of really mapping out all the different kinds of internet service provided to communities all over the Commonwealth. And this is, we've zoomed in here to Norfolk for the purposes of this, to show you that generally speaking, the supply of internet access, the infrastructure for it, through cable line, and in a limited way through fiber optic line is pretty much everywhere in Norfolk, save some of the heavy industrial areas and train yards over in the Norfolk Southern coal piers. there are other types of internet access and subscriptions available in the city through phone lines and then some satellite coverage. But for the most part, as we all know, cable wireline through through Cox is the primary means through which internet subscriptions are provided at the household level. Next, please. So what does it mean to have a subscription? This is some data that we leverage from the American Community Survey. This is authoritative federal data that's collected annually by the Census Bureau. This is different than the data that is that was just recently collected for the 10-year census, where the primary goal is to count all individuals where they are on a certain date. The ACS really provides very detailed characteristics about households on an ongoing basis on education, employment, transportation, to include access to the internet. And so we've leveraged that data and to help kind of quantify the state of the internet in Norfolk. So to orient you, we're gonna move from left to right here. Total households in Norfolk that are estimated in the most recent, most reliable 5-year data estimates from the ACS is that there's just over 88,000 reported households in Norfolk. And that next column, about 72,000 of those households report an active internet subscription of some sort. Just over 12,000 report no internet access at their household, and then a small number report some sort of access without a subscription. These are some outliers where perhaps an apartment complex provides it on behalf of the resident. They don't have a subscription, but they have access. Or, for example, the Housing Authority provides its residents in some of our public housing facilities. And so that kind of captures the breakout of the internet subscriptions or lack thereof in Norfolk. Moving over to the right, about 58,000 households report having cellular data plans that access the internet. Now, this could be their only means of access in the internet, or it could be in addition to an internet subscription through, say, Cox, through a cable line. 58,000 report access also through cellular data. And then there are almost 13,000 households that report internet access through cellular data alone and no other type of internet subscription. So we've our estimate is that combining the cellular-only category and the no internet access category gives us about 25,000, just over 25,000 households, or 29% of the households in Norfolk that have limited or no household internet access. And at, with incomes, households with incomes less than 20,000, that number is about 40% of households. Just over 18,000 households have no internet access. And we do not have, the data is a little incomplete at the cellular plan level for income, so we can only speak to no internet access at for income.
Hey, Pete, can I ask a real quick question?
Yes, ma'am.
Of those households, do you know how many have school-aged children? And I ask that specifically because the product that Cox provides, Cox to Compete, only is available for households with school-aged children. So does that... Is it possible to break that data out, or do we not have that?
I think I don't have it tonight, but I think we could go back and get that, because populations and households and various things like that are included in the ACS. So I'm fairly certain that we could go back and find out that information of those households, okay, as you described.
Thank you.
No problem. Next slide, please. And this slide is a geographic representation of the data that we presented in the last slide. And this shows at the census block group level, those 29% of households with limited or no internet access in their household. And you can see for each of the block groups in the legend there is the percentage of the households in that block group that report either no or limited internet access. So there are some areas of the city that we've keyed in on. And with that, I'm gonna hand the microphone over to Fraser Picard, our Chief Information Officer, who's gonna talk about some of our public Wi-Fi efforts to help fill some of these gaps in service and access to the internet across the city for our most in need residents. Fraser?
Thank you, Pete. Next slide, please. So in the past, when we talk about making Wi-Fi available, the traditional route has been to make it available inside of city facilities. But due to the pandemic, we really had to take a different look at this. So we came up with a plan to figure out how can we identify where Wi-Fi is available at city facilities and also opportunities for expansion. Working with Norfolk Public Schools, libraries, recreation parks and open space, Slover and communications, we were able to identify 61 sites throughout the city that had Wi-Fi that was available outside of the buildings. Now, the unfortunate thing is sometimes that signal could be weak and you had to get close to the building, but at least there was a Wi-Fi signal available. The other thing we did was to take all the different Wi-Fi names at each of these different locations and make it one. So now the experience for the user will be the same no matter what facility you go to. It will always be Connect Norfolk, except for the public schools. They already had branded theirs as NPS Connect. So we agreed they didn't need to change theirs, but at least for the rest of the city facilities, it'll be Connect Norfolk. And we made sure that it was available 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. The next thing we did is using the data that Pete presented, we mapped existing locations and then tried to identify future locations. Now, these expansion areas had to be where there were already city facilities available to put the Wi-Fi on. So what happens is we end up installing equipment inside the building and then a device on the outside of the building to create that Wi-Fi range outside of the building. The last thing we did was come up with a communications plan. So we needed a way to get the information out to residents. And this included not only a website with an interactive map, but also using social media and working with neighborhoods to get the information out to leaders in neighborhoods to share this information. Next slide. So on the communications plan on the left, you can see we used obviously social media, the city's website, and once again, the neighborhood specialists, we gave them material to hand out. And we also put up signs at facilities so people would know there was Wi-Fi available. Some of the examples are shown below of the material that the Department of Communications came up with. We also reached out to obviously Norfolk Public Schools, NRHA, which is also working on a plan to provide Wi-Fi in their properties, and then once again, the neighborhood community groups. Our GIS team, working with communications, did develop a website. I'm pleased to announce that we've had over 1,100 visitors to this website looking for information on public Wi-Fi. This website is both a mashup of information, videos, and also an interactive map. The map allows you to search for Wi-Fi locations within a distance of an address, or you can look at a citywide map. And then the third option is you can actually print a map out, a PDF map, or download it and email it to people. So there are a variety of different options to get the information out. Next slide. So the map under phase one shows the 61 sites we identified with Wi-Fi that was available outside the building. I should joke that this was not a very scientific analysis. We ended up going out with different devices, tablets, cell phones, and going up and seeing if we could get a connection. So I have to thank the staff for running around to all these sites to figure out which ones we could do this at. But you can see we've done a quick analysis just walking 10 minutes. 40% of the land area is within a 10-minute walk of a Wi-Fi site currently. Right now, we are in phase two. And what phase two consists of is either working right now with about 15 of the recreation centers to add Wi-Fi to them, and also, if possible, boost the signal outside the Wi-Fi, outside the recreation centers. So that's what the second map shows. And in phase two, we hope to have this completed by January. And then the last map, we will add additional sites, and you will see by the time we're done, hopefully by June of 2021, 47% of the city will be within a 10-minute walk to a Wi-Fi site. Next slide. So what's going to happen after we do all this? So we are working with vendors to look at solutions to adding Wi-Fi and other sensor technology to large open spaces. So one of the hard places to cover are things like parks, where we don't have a building we can attach the Wi-Fi to. And even if we could, it probably wouldn't fill the whole park. So we're looking at solutions for large open public spaces. We want to start looking at monitoring the Wi-Fi utilization. Right now, the numbers we get are for the entire network, not individual sites. So we're trying to break that down to individual sites. We should be getting our first report next later on this month to help us begin to see how many people are actually utilizing it. And then one of the things I think is very important is we need to start looking at these Wi-Fi sites and what happens when the power goes out. So people are going to become very dependent upon this, and what happens if the power goes out. So we're in the process of identifying which sites have generators at them so they could still operate if the power went out. Lastly, I think many of you are aware we are working on a regional fiber ring. Ms. McClellan is heading that up for representing the city of Norfolk. And 5G service, if you're not aware, this is the new cellular service that will provide very high speed access, cellular access. And Verizon and AT&T have started in that process here in Norfolk. And this will give greater options for how people can access the internet. Next slide. So what are the takeaways that Pete and I would like you to see? So obviously, internet service is about 29% of the households here in Norfolk have no or limited access. We've made progress in filling this gap by finding these sites and more planned in the future. And that new initiatives such as the regional fiber ring and 5G are coming to our region and should increase internet access options for residents. So I want to thank you and see if there are any questions for Pete and myself.
Thank you, Frazier. Thank you, Pete. Any questions for Frazier or for Pete? Ms. McClellan?
This is really great. I appreciate it, guys. That 29% number is really stark to me. It's not that these residents don't have access, it's that they likely can't afford the access. And so as a city, I appreciate that we're trying to put more Wi-Fi out at our public buildings, but that also means people having to go in their cars and sit in a parking lot while they're completing their schoolwork or they're visiting with their doctor via telehealth. What can we be doing to ensure that there are, I mean, I think certainly the regional fiber ring to create more internet competition and hopefully bring down prices is one way. Are there other areas that we could be addressing that? I asked the question about Cox to compete and the homes with school children. That is not a federal mandate. That's Cox's choice. But what about the homes with seniors or homes that don't have kids in them? So they can't afford those. Anyway, I just think this is a big issue. 29% is a huge chunk of our community, and it is not an amenity. It is a utility. So I'd like to have that discussion.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. McCullough. Frazier or Pete, you want to try to take a stab at that, or you want to get back with some answers?
So I think there's one. It's not maybe the best solution, but it is a very popular solution, and that is, of course, the libraries have MiFi devices that can be checked out up to 3 weeks. I recently was at a conference, virtual conference, and San Jose handed out 13,000 of those this year to residents. We have about 80 more are ordered. The problem is, we are not the only locality ordering MiFi devices right now, and so there is a back order. But I think you're right, there are other solutions. NRHA is really trying to address their properties too, and getting Wi-Fi installed in there. I've talked to the acting IT director over there, and they are working on that at their properties.
Okay, Ms. Graves, and then Mr. Smigel.
Thank you. I was on a call for elected officials with Norfolk Public Schools, and that Andrea's point was one that was made. I think Mamie was on that call as well, where there is internet, but the cost of accessing it is out of the reach of a lot of the families of the student population. So we definitely need to see what we can do in order to bring that cost down or have some kind of regulation on it or supplement or something, because putting it out there is one thing, but if people can't access it because they can't afford it, is totally something different. So that's a problem across the board that I think we need to address, and it affects families with school-aged children with regard to them being able to do their work. So it's a very important issue.
Okay. Mrs. Eagle. And then Ms. Johnson.
Yep. Thank you for the presentation. Interesting data. I love the maps. Did your data consider the amount of MiFis that Norfolk Public Schools already gave out to students? Because I believe they've given out close to 10,000 of those. From T-Mobile. I might be off on my number, but there was quite a bit that were given out. Initially, I think it was 2,000, but then they saw a dramatic increase in that. I know it's not necessarily high-speed internet, but for those that did not have internet, this did add that availability. And how, even after the pandemic, even though the district is paying for those, I think out of CARES Act funds, how we could continue to pay for those to stay at homes that need them. And then I'm also, I believe I saw a school board presentation in which the school system announced that they did connect Cox Communications with families of income needs with the Cox to Connect program. So they had shared contact information, or there must have been some kind of legal way that they were able to do that so that they could reach out to families that could need that, and Cox had extended that opportunity. But I saw you shake your head no, so I'm assuming you didn't include that in the data. But it'd be interesting to see how much Norfolk Public Schools actually ended up giving out and where those are located throughout the city.
So yeah, just to answer real quick about the data, yeah, those descriptions were as of the end of 2018, so there is some latency there, and certainly there are some estimates from 2019, and we don't have anything for 2020 from that source yet. So for the data that we described there, did not reflect any of the technology that's been provided during the pandemic for public school households.
Hey, Tommy, if you took that 25,000, and let's just assume it's a 10,000 MiFis, you still have a delta of 15,000 homes without it. So, just to say.
All right, Ms. Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Frazier and Mr. Burek, for your presentation. One of the things that you mentioned was, although there are areas that have broadband and Wi-Fi, there are weak signals. So my question is, how do we strengthen the signals that throughout the city, especially in areas where we're struggling to bring about internet and broadband, so that parents can have the accessibility, so that people can have the accessibility. One of the things that I hear all the time as far as technology is concerned, is even with people who can afford internet service, is the competition side. It is one company able to provide all of the necessary needs for the city of Norfolk? What about the competition? There is much feedback from the citizens of Norfolk, and they can afford the internet. And so they're waiting for us as a council as a whole to see if we can do things a little better. And also, are we looking at with the broadband? I know that for broadband, it is in our master plan. And there's great potential, especially when you have a library and you have a recreation center there, and people are still having difficulties with getting the accessibility. So I'm really interested in, I appreciate your report, and I'm really interested on us seeing how we can be creative to bring about this broadband and Wi-Fi accessibility to everybody in the city of Norfolk, and that we narrow the gap. And as Councilwoman Graves said, yes, we were on the Bring Your Legislator to Work, I think, day or something, Bring Your Legislator to School Day. And that was a part of the discussion that we had with our legislators, our state legislators. So thank you again for your report.
All right, Mrs. Smingle.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I wanted to mention one other thing about competition. Even if we were to bring in another competitor to Cox in Norfolk, if that could happen, say Verizon, Fios wanted to come in, which I know all of us would love that because of, you know, our constituents and the constant request for options, it doesn't necessarily bring down the prices to an affordable rate for people that want internet. And anybody who has relatives or knows people in Virginia Beach, which one, there are parts of Virginia Beach that do not have Fios. That's a misnomer because we get that all the time that people say, well, Virginia Beach has competition, why can't Norfolk? But two, where they do have competition, the prices are not much lower with them. It comes down a little bit, but the main thing is the cable. That's what people really wanted initially, but now that there's a lot of competition with streaming television programs, even Cox has realized that that's not a market anymore that's big for them. It is about the internet and providing the internet so people can stream television. And I'm not speaking for Cox, and I don't want to put any words, but just from, you know, conversations that I've had with people that are in Verizon and Cox, they work for both. So I just want to, you know, be careful. Competition doesn't necessarily bring down the prices that would be affordable for the people who can't afford internet right now to even be able to pay for that. And really it is, we'd have to bring in a lot more competition to do that, or new companies that can tack into the, you know, the fiber ring and run new lines in. That's where the real competition comes in at the end of the day.
Okay. Well, thank you all. Thank you, Frazier. Thank you, Pete. Great presentation. Thank you very much. Dr. Feiler.
Thank you, sir. Thought maybe we could take a quick 5-minute break, stretch our legs, and come back for council interest. Before we do that, I failed to mention one thing at the start. My apologies to Kurt Krause and Visit Norfolk. I wanted to let council know that we did get word today probably this won't come as a surprise to any of you. Condé Nast Traveler has ranked their 10 most friendly cities, 10 friendliest cities in the United States for 2020. Norfolk made the list at number 7. So very good news for the city of Norfolk. I think we all recognize how friendly it is and has remained friendly even through some difficult times during the summer. With that, sir, I would recommend we take a quick 5-minute break, let everybody stretch their legs, and then come back for council interest.
Thank you.
good afternoon. Can you hear me?
I can hear you, sir.
Yes, sir, Ms. Riddick.
Good afternoon, and thanks for this opportunity. I guess my concern has always and still is the condition of the streets and roads in Poplar Hall, Stonebridge Manor, and Eagleside. About 2 years ago, there was something, a spill or something, a hole in Stonebridge Manor. And I was promised then that the entire community would be resurfaced. Nothing has happened, and we still have that black eye in the middle of the main entrance to Stonebridge. The same thing with Poplar Hall. I have always spoken about the condition of the streets in Poplar Hall. And 3 years ago, I was promised that that community would be resurfaced. And they even had a new type of sealant that was a little less expensive than asphalt, but nothing has happened. And I don't want to pick a fight, but last year during the budget cycle, somebody mentioned that the community roadway down 38th Street, I can't think of the word I'm looking for, and that was done because they actually came back and thanked the community for doing that. And you don't protect real estate tax relief that way, not relief, but real estate taxes. And in Stonebridge and Poplar Halls, two prominent African-American communities that you would probably want to attract somebody from Chesapeake or Virginia Beach, but we can't even keep your roads straight. The same council person who I admire tremendously has come up with an idea of buying a piece of property on Granby Street and putting some townhouses there. And I guarantee the city is looking for a way to find that $1 million. Well, we can't continue to do work like that. We can't continue to ignore the east side of the city. They say Black Lives Matter, but I'm writing an editorial because Black conditions in Black communities don't matter. And we have to take a deep breath and tell these individuals, say, listen, hey, it's a good idea. Maybe we can do it later. But we need to take care of the communities that's paying the regular tax rates without tearing up the front end of their car. And Mr. Alexander, I don't know how in the world you ride to work every morning and look at the conditions of Poplar Halls, and I know you want to be neutral, and that's admirable, but we just can't continue to ignore our African-American communities that we want to attract people from Chesapeake and Virginia Beach from. And we have time to work on that because there would be no resurfacing during the winter. But next spring, we need to come out with a way to go through Poplar Halls, go through Stonebridge, and try to attract other communities, not necessarily African Americans, because all communities are moving in now. So let's prepare ourselves to be able to accommodate just a simple thing, which is streets and roadways. I think that's all I have, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, Mr. Riddick. All right, Mr.
Smigel. All right, I said last time I had a million and I needed to prepare for them, so I have a long list. Actually, I think it's only four. First one, fairly easy. Just I wanted to remind everybody that I had asked on behalf of the gaming committee, Councilwoman Johnson and I, the committee would like a permanent commission for the casino in gaming in Norfolk, and I just wanted to make sure that everybody is okay with that so that we can move forward with drafting that language to have a permanent committee to have oversight over that. I believe, Mr. Mayor, you're okay with that. That was one of the recommendations that came out of the committee.
Tommy, I think that I would not limit it. I would not limit it to just the casino. I think that as your committee looked at other platforms of gaming right. that's coming online, so let's talk about you know what that looks like because you're going to have you know other
sports betting game. And gray machines may stay once they do a full analysis of how much money it's actually bringing into the state. If you want to throw marijuana in there too, we could do gaming and marijuana. We could do both because that would probably be coming as well. But I'm assuming everybody's okay with that, so we can start working on the language of having some kind of oversight committee on that. We just want to make sure we do it correctly. So beggars and panhandlers on our street corners. Obviously, with the pandemic, there has been an increase. I've received just a few concerns about there's no mask wearing and people are walking up to cars to get money. When I've addressed this before with the police, I have three intersections in particular in my ward that there's a consistent issue with this. They were told that they had to stand down on this issue because the city attorney's office gave advice that it was legal for panhandlers to stand on corners and beg. I did not follow up with that with the city attorney's office, but I have a concern about this. And I know some cities have printed signs and they put them on medians that say, please do not give money to panhandlers or beggars. We have support in our city for those who need it. Here's a number to call. I've seen that in a couple cities. It's getting a little bit rampant, and I understand maybe because of the pandemic, there's a little bit more of an increase in this, but it is a safety issue, not only with exposure with the pandemic, but also with people going in and out of traffic. These are not youth leagues begging for money to buy uniforms and stuff. These are actually homeless people that are doing this or people in need. And I think that as a city, we need to figure out what the law really says on this, what we could do to be proactive with it. If the interpretation was that the police are just not allowed to approach them, then that's one thing. But if it's illegal, we need to know this. I'd love to hear some, you know, thoughts from my colleagues on that. I can stop on that. I have two more other issues. If anybody else has any thoughts or if Bernard wants to talk about it.
You're correct. The law is really clear now that localities cannot prohibit solicitation for money, begging. Judge Fulton particularly considered our ordinance. We tried to avoid the ruling, but he felt so strongly about it that he has declared it to be unconstitutional, so that, like other cities, putting up signs, encouraging people, and this is just anecdotal, but I think we all see them, and the people that I observe appear to be doing it as an occupation, brought in, and not a homeless person. It is difficult to deal with it when our Constitution permits it. It does not permit interference with traffic. So we can work on and bring to you what options appear to be legal, but our current ordinance is clearly unconstitutional, and we cannot flat out prohibit it as we have done. So why don't I bring something back to you to discuss and get it going?
Okay, thank you.
All right.
Two other issues.
Before you go,
Go ahead.
Riddick, then Ms. Johnson, want to speak to that. Mr. Riddick first, then Ms. Johnson. Mr. Riddick, then Ms. Johnson.
I can appreciate, you know, what you're talking about, Tommy, but this is an awful time, and people kind of really need that money. Somebody even told me one time that they had, it was a business that they had two or three people working one site, which, you know, would turn us down. But as long as they're respectful, that's grabbing car handle, regardless of what they look, they could look like, who would have thought it? I think we should live in that deal. And that's, you know, that's just the way I look at it. I appreciate your position, Tommy, and because you are, you know, whatever. But I think you need to live in that deal. That's me. Thank you.
Ms. Johnson.
Oh, I just wanted to say, Councilman Smigel, I had asked a question as well in our reference to the children with some of the organization because of the safety. They are out in major intersection, whereas the adults are over to the side. In so many words, not monitoring the children. So that was a big concern of mine. And so Berner came back and said, because of the law, that, you know, it was just the concern of mine. So I just wanted to add to that as well, that the children are a huge concern as well as what you're talking about, because they are soliciting funding, and we discussed maybe they need to focus on different ways of fundraising more so than having the children in the major fairways intersections asking for money.
Mr. Smigel, you may continue with your concern.
Great, thank you. You know, I want to commend the city of Norfolk on our efforts that we did in order to drive up our census numbers. And I know that most of us read the article about what happened and where our current rate is. I think our rate would have been a lot worse had we not done the work that we had previously done. I think we are actually in a good place considering what we have to deal with. I'm not sure, and maybe Mamie and Angela have heard, is there any national movement for cities to sue the federal government over the stoppage of census and what this could actually cause when it comes to funding? And Adisa, you may be there as well, but Norfolk is set to possibly lose millions of dollars because we were not allowed to continue doing our count, or the census did not follow through with their promises, and also with Donald Trump's action of stopping it. In the, you know, I really feel like Norfolk is getting penalized heavily with future funds on this, and and it's going to be major cities that are going to be impacted the most by this, and whether or not any of us could join in a lawsuit to sue the federal government on this, or if we need to go through the Attorney General, Mark Herring's office, to file a lawsuit to take care of that. It's very insulting what happened. And it's very sad to hear that, you know, other localities are also facing the same thing that we are. It also has implications with representation in the government. I think that's an even a bigger aspect of this. I don't know how we proceed with this as a city, or if there's any interest, we just let it go and suck it up and move forward. But I think we would have exceeded our rate from 10 years ago had we had normal conditions with the work that we were doing.
So Tommy, we will research it. We'll draft a letter to Mark Herring and have Adisa to do a survey across the country to see if there is any type of class action suit at play.
Tommy, also too, Mr. Mayor, there may be an opportunity to partner with the National League of Cities To my knowledge right now, there isn't, but I can tell you that it is a great concern for those members in the National Black Caucus of local elected officials, as well as those in the National League of Cities organization as a whole. And if there isn't a class action lawsuit somewhere being talked about, I think that we could definitely act as a leader on that and move that effort forward and use our partners in NLC to help make that happen and to help spread the word, because not only are large cities suffering, but small ones are too, because it was more difficult for their count committees to get to people in the first place. And so to have that, you know, to have COVID and then have, you know, the abrupt shortage of time, it's been very difficult. So large cities and small cities, counties and towns are struggling as well. And they're going to struggle.
All right, Mr. Smigley, you may continue. Ms. Johnson, tell me 1 second. Ms. Johnson, go right on.
Councilman Smigel, the other part was the concern, people who had filled out their census, they were still getting information to say you needed to fill out your census information. I was one of them. I mean, the constant mailing, the constant forms that I received, as well as other information to say that I did not fill out my census information. So therefore, then it was on me, my responsibility, to find out and track down what the location was that my census information was not received. So that was an issue. That was the second issue that I heard. So thank you, Councilman Smigel, for bringing up that concern, sir.
Yeah, because if I was Martin Thomas, I'd be worried with that response rate. He may not have anybody left in his ward because they didn't respond to the census. So,
all right.
Sorry, I had to go there. My last one is about commercial code enforcement, and I can talk about that at another level. I know that's been a concern brought up. I have businesses along Little Creek Road that have signs for over 2 years and nobody has had them fix it. I don't want to mess with them now with the pandemic, but you know, once things get going back up, we really need to clean up our commercial corridor areas and start really putting some code enforcement in on these businesses that have not been good stewards of making our city look good with their businesses. You know, we've had right now some easy things are we've got, you know, used car lots that park their cars all the way up to the street, you know, over sidewalks and street lines, past telephone poles. And we really just need to increase that to make Norfolk continue Norfolk to be the friendliest place for people to come to. It just looks bad at some parts of our down Military Highway, Little Creek Road, some of our major commercial areas that we don't have that enforcement, but we can talk about that, you know, later. But that's all I have for tonight.
Thank you, Mr. Smigel. Ms. Graves.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I only have a couple things. The first thing I would like to say is I agree with Tommy and the Gaming Commission's recommendation on having a permanent committee. I think it's important because there are a lot of groups out there that think that they can just go to the tribe and make deals with the tribe on, you know, policies regarding the city of Norfolk. And I think that the Gaming Commission would serve as a buffer between the two to make sure that these organizations are legitimate, that their representatives are legitimate, and that their concerns are legitimate, and be able to, you know, work with our city attorney and our city manager to be able to oversee their regulations. So I think that's very important with regard to that. So I totally support that. And then the other thing is I put forth a child care initiative. We're going into like 9 months of COVID. And Chip, I know you told me it's being worked on, but you guys showed us how quickly you could work on stuff. and it doesn't take that long for y'all to work on stuff. And so I need y'all to work on this. And I mean, we got people who could greatly benefit from these neighborhood child care centers. Y'all have been sitting on this for months now. And I really don't understand what the holdup is with it. And, you know, how much bureaucracy do we have to go through in order to help people take care of kids? I mean, it's a simple philosophy of helping people take care of kids so that people can go to work. So I really would like to see that before January, hopefully. I'd like to see it so that we can, you know, going into the new year, folks can have an opportunity to get their children child care. And then the last thing is, I know we brought back Lenny Newcomb in planning, and I continue to get complaints about the way planning is just handling things and not responding and taking forever and all that kind of stuff. So I'd like for us to get an update on what Lenny is doing and how that's working and what policies you guys are putting in place to be there. There are other cities that are doing things differently with regard to that. And we have builders that are trying to build in the city of Norfolk to help increase. I mean, people are still buying houses in the pandemic. And so if you got people who want to buy houses and you got builders who want to build houses, then to me, it seems like, and I do have a dog in that fight, but it does seem like we would do everything that we could to help facilitate that process so that, you know, we could continue to generate tax revenue since we're losing so much of it in the hospitality industry. That's all I got.
Thank you so much. Ms. Johnson. Hold on a second.
I just want to address
Ms. Graves, one moment.
Councilwoman Graves.
Thank you.
Councilwoman Graves, so Mr. Newcomb has been on the job now for a few months, so we have him scheduled to come in on December 22nd and brief you all with, you know, kind of what he's found so far and what they're working on. Really quickly on the family day homes, let me mention the city attorney's office did get back to us. They have provided some information about our path from a regulatory standpoint forward. That maybe we don't have a lot of room in that because of our charter. However, both Mr. Rogers and Denise Gallup with Human Services, we're still looking at the possibility of, you know, a program to engage and educate and perhaps provide, you know, like a seal of approval thing, something like that. And so we are working on that part of it. And I have more to say on that on actually pre-January. That will also be on December 22nd.
Thank you. If we need a charter change, we got an upcoming session.
I'd have to talk to Mr. Pishko again, but I think it was more than just that.
It's okay. Not in our charter. The General Assembly permits counties to regulate small child care centers. I think the cutoff number is 5, but doesn't permit cities. And so that would probably be better to be a General Assembly action, and that would enable us to provide the same type of regulation for the smaller as the larger, but it would not be likely to increase the supply, which I think is an issue that is not related to regulation.
Thank you.
Okay,
Ms. Johnson?
Oh, thank you, Mr. Mayor. One concern that I have, all the others have been addressed by Mr. Chip Fowler. Our bulk pickup. So I'm trying to understand better about our bulk pickup. I do understand, but I think that we need more consistency. During the pandemic, people have been really working on their homes, at least let them have something to do. So in the process of them really taking pleasure of merging and purging, fixing up their homes, which we want them to do, it is extremely difficult for our citizens. when they call in for a bulk pickup, that some of them are being told after the bulk is out on the curb that they will not be able to receive a bulk pickup until the following week. From my understanding, there is also a limit on, based on your residency, I guess, they're tracking it, how much bulk can be picked up by each resident in the city of Norfolk, and that we have more consistency. Because with that bulk being out there, it's also making our city, as council as a whole has discussed, it doesn't look good. It doesn't bring about beautification in our city, in our neighborhoods. And one thing I did learn from a real estate point of view, when realtors come into our communities with potential buyers, they look at all of that. I think Councilwoman Graves, you mentioned that years ago. They look at the amount of trash that's in your community. So if my neighbor has their bulk out for a week and can't get it picked up till the following, that says something about our neighborhoods. So if you could, if we could look at some other ways of being more consistent with our bulk pickup, that would be great.
Okay. Yeah, thanks, Councilwoman Johnson. I appreciate the comment. We do need folks to schedule before they do, right? Just in case we aren't going to be able to get to them until the next week, right? And I think that's a messaging thing that, well, I'll work with communications and see if we can really get out a messaging campaign that, you know, if you're anticipating that you're going to do work, go to the website and schedule and make sure you can get that slot before you actually go and do the work. Let me work with Mr. Benda and Lori Crouch and see if we can't get a better message out to everybody about that.
That would be great. Thank you, Mr. Manager.
Thank you, Ms. Johnson. Ms. McClellan.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. A couple things. Ms. Graves, Councilwoman Graves, there might be an opportunity also, Mr. Mayor, to work with the First Lady. I talked with Pam Northam recently. She's doing a lot with early childhood, but also which gets into the childcare side of things. And maybe there's an opportunity for Norfolk to be a pilot location for some of the work that she's doing. And so I think that I absolutely agree and concur that childcare is a huge part of getting our economy back to work. And, you know, so many women are adversely affected because of the childcare issue. So I support you completely on there. So maybe we could look into that. There was a great editorial, I think it was in today's paper, about our kids in school. And I'm sure all of us are getting a lot of pressure both to get kids back in school and keep them out of school. But I don't know what we are not responsible for that. That is a school board issue. But the pilot editorial was talking about thinking outside the box and thinking of maybe using city facilities to provide more open spaces and bigger spaces. And I just would encourage us to continue to figure out ways, particularly getting to that childcare issue, that K through six, these little ones, you know, parents are having to go back to work, and you can't leave a third grader at home online to do school. We've got to figure out this. We just can't keep doing this. And Mr. Smigel, I should defer to you. You're obviously the educator, as is Ms. Johnson in the group. And I don't know there's a good answer for anybody, but we've got to somehow or another get into the middle of this. And I think just saying it's the school board's issue.
Thank you for using Cisco.
Did we time out? So are we over our limit?
I can't answer that one.
We have timed out.
she had an end.
Telephonically, let's just call her. We still can do telephonically. So we just can, everybody call somebody.
Hang on, let me see if I can set up
a new one.
That doesn't help with the meeting notice.
We'll just have to live with it. We're telephonically right now.
Could you go telephone? I said both. I can do telephonically or, yeah, you can do telephonically.
Call.
I can call. How many people can I call, man?
You get three with yours, right? One you and two others. And then you get one, two,
three. Okay.
Six. We got them.
All
right,
who's doing it? I'll do Martin.
All right.
I'll call Andrew. Mary, you want me to do that?
You gonna get
Andrew? I'll get Angela.
Yeah, I get Martin. Mr. Riddick? Mr. Riddick, you say by the phone, Mr. Riddick.
Hey, we're calling everybody. The WebEx timed out, okay?
Hey, the WebEx timed out.
They put a time limit on the table. Thing, so I'm going to
telephonic. Everybody's calling somebody.
No, not at all.
Okay. So just text me if you want to say something. All right. Thanks, man.
All right. So you next. Okay.
So Bonnie, can you hear me?
I only have. I think I can call Tommy. Have you got him already?
I'm in. Yeah, I'll call Tommy. 214 number.
Yeah. Okay. That's good. You're my man. That's why you're my man.
Yeah, Carl.
I've got to get you on here.
James getting Mamie.
Okay. Hey, Tommy. Everybody's on a different phone, but we can all hear each other. So hold on 1 second.
Yeah, we're going to go and close session. We got to get Courtney, Andrea. Andrea needs to finish her.
Yeah.
Andrea, you on?
I'm on.
Okay, go ahead and finish.
The only thing is, for brevity, I just wanted. I was curious where we were in spending down our CARES Act funding, recognizing we have until the end of the calendar year to do so. So maybe that could be a future presentation, Chip.
Yes, ma'am. We're also going to schedule that for December 22nd to give you a wrap up of the CARES money.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep. Thank you.
All done.
All right, Mr. Thomas.
I have no concerns.
No thank concerns. You. You're a good man. All right, Ms. Doyle.
Do we have Ms. Doyle?
Who's got Courtney? Oh. Nobody's got Courtney.
Okay, hold on a second.
Hold on, let me get Courtney.
So the WebEx timed out, so everybody is on mobile phones, cell phones here, sitting in the middle of the table. So I'm going to patch you through, okay?
Okay.
All right, Courtney, you're up for your concerns. Courtney?
Yep, I'm here.
Okay,
you cast
your concerns.
Are you asking me to speak, Mr.
Yes.
Mayor? I spoke yesterday about a few matters, so I don't need to raise those. One thing I would just like to ask, can we follow up with the school division to find out where they are with turning over buildings back to us that they're no longer using, and also looking at the buildings that are underutilized? And I don't say that in a funny way because I know none are being utilized right now, but before COVID, there were buildings underutilized, and they were considering turning those over to us as well. So can we follow up with them on that?
Yes, ma'am, we will.
Okay, that was my interest for tonight.
All right, Mr. Bull?
Yes, I move that members of the council assemble informally in a closed meeting on December 1, 2020 at
6:35 p.m. in the 10th floor conference room of the 10th floor conference room of the City Hall building in the City of Norfolk for the purposes which are set out in Clause 1, Subsection A of Section 2.2-3711 of the Gender Freedom of Information Act as amended. Clause 1 is the discussion of a personnel matter. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Ms. McClellan?
I just want to say this is so 2020.
Aye. Mr. Riddick? Aye. Thank you, sir. Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Oh, okay. Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Thank you. Dr. Alexander?
Aye.